entrance. They wonder how they might enter the tomb to anoint Jesus' body with spices. But when they arrive, they discover that the unimaginable has happened. They find the stone rolled away. Fear grips their hearts as they step inside, only to find that the tomb is empty and that the body of Jesus isn't there. Suddenly, two angels of the Lord appear before them, each wearing white. And with a roar of lightning and thunder, they declare, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen." Those words echo deeply into their souls, dispelling the darkness of grief and despair. For Jesus, the one they've given their hearts and lives to, is indeed alive. Today you're invited to discover the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and to experience the overwhelming gift of grace and salvation that's being offered through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus.
Drinking in the morning sun, blinking in the morning sun, saddened by the things they've done, heavy like a loaded gun. What made them behave that way? Forsake, betray. I can only think it must be hate. Oh, anyway, it's looking like a beautiful day. Moved, you've gone away. I know the truth, you rose today. Well, anyway, it's looking like a beautiful day.
Why don't you stand?
Throw those curtains wide. is one.
On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive.
Yeah, throw those curtains wide.
On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive.
Jesus, throw those curtains wide.
On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive.
Throw those curtains wide.
Saint Jesus is alive.
Yeah, yeah.
Throw those curtains wide.
On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive. Amen. Happy Easter. Happy Easter to you all. Welcome, everybody. It's great to see you. And a big thank you to Francesca, who rewrote the Elbow song for us. It was slightly beyond me. So can we just give Francesca a round of applause? She's an amazing wordsmith. Okay, so I hope you're ready to celebrate this morning. I'm not sure you were ready for that, but you've got to be ready to boogie now, okay? So it's just be free. We're going to have quite a relaxed time of worship. And let's celebrate Jesus is risen.
You, and I'm gonna praise you. Lord, we just praise you this morning. We thank you that you are risen. You are risen indeed. And we just praise you and we want to celebrate you this morning.
Chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory.
Please do take your seats. Welcome to church this morning. Some of you were a little bit late, and that means you missed an extravaganza of a song. So band, if it's okay with you, can you replay it later while the others are doing their craft? Is that okay? Fabulous. So you won't get to miss out after all. Well, today we come to mark Easter, and we've got some words to share together. So Jonathan, if we could have the slide on the screen. I'm going to say Christ is risen. A holy disruption. I'm going to say Christ is risen, alleluia. And if together we could say he is risen indeed, alleluia, that would be fabulous. Are you ready, friends? Nice and loud. Christ is risen, alleluia.
He is risen alleluia.
Today we come together to celebrate and mark Easter joy, not out of habit and not only thinking about chocolate, but there is chocolate, but with an exciting awareness of Christ's presence with us today and in all the days ahead, because he is the risen Lord, Lord of the church, Lord of our lives, and Lord of the world. So we're going to say it again, loudly and proudly. Christ is risen, hallelujah!
He is risen,
I'm not sure anyone's hearing that, friends. Come on, it's Easter Sunday. Christ is risen, hallelujah! Fabulous, fabulous. Now, if you've been involved in church this week, you might have wondered what on earth was going on. Because on Tuesday, I got to do assemblies with all of the Penwortham kids. And I invited all of the kids from Penwortham School to join us in the Garden of Discovery when they broke up from school on Wednesday. That was a great idea, wasn't it? Invite all the kids to join us in the garden. And we had no clue who would turn up. But what we did want to do was to give the kids of our community an opportunity to hear the good news of Jesus for themselves. So, dotted around the room, you will see some sheets that have some characters in Lego. And the characters are in Lego, not to dumb down the Easter story, but to help children remember the story, because we want them to know the good news, don't we, friends? So we invited all of the school to join us in the garden to listen to the Easter story through the lens of five characters. So we had Over here, number one, Peter, lovingly played by Jane. We had Pilate, who took his role very seriously in Steve, as you can imagine. And then we had the centurion. We had Mary Magdalene, played lovingly. Oh, Julia was the centurion, by the way. Yeah, that's right. Julia was the centurion in full kit. And then we had Claire playing Mary Magdalene. And we had Janet dressed as the angel, wearing her wedding dress, looking beautifully angelic with wings. And the trail is actually, it's here for you to have a look at later. You can use your phone, and it uses technology. It uses something called augmented reality to bring the story. So you scan the QR code, and then you hold your phone over the picture, and then it brings the story up on your phone. And it tells the story through that person's perspective. And then there's a question that the character has to know the answer to. And when the kids give the answer, they get their little tick on their sheet, and if they collect all the bits, then they got chocolate. And we had no idea what to expect. Not at all. But we had over 100 kids and their parents and carers come through the doors, getting to engage with the Easter story. And so we didn't want you to miss out. So it is here for you to have a look at later. But all the pieces of the story are put together, and we're going to watch the video now so that you don't miss out on it either. Jonathan.
The Easter story begins on Palm Sunday. Jesus entered Jerusalem on a donkey. The crowds shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They waved palm branches and laid their cloaks on the ground. A few days later, Jesus and his disciples were sharing the Passover meal. Jesus predicted that one of them would betray him, and his disciples were shocked and saddened. Jesus broke the bread and said, "This is my body, broken for you." Then he took the wine and said, "This is my blood of the covenant, poured out for many." Jesus said to Peter, "Before the cock crows this very night, you will disown me 3 times. But Peter insisted, "I am willing to die with you, Jesus. I will never disown you." Jesus and his disciples went out to the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus asked his disciples to keep watch while he prayed. "Abba, Father," he said, "everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Then Judas came to betray Jesus to the Jewish leaders. Jesus was arrested and the disciples ran away. The Jewish leaders put Jesus on trial before the high priest. Even though Jesus was innocent, he didn't defend himself from the false accusations made against him. When the high priest asked Jesus, "Are you the Messiah?" Jesus answered, "I am." Then the high priest condemned Jesus to death and beat him. While Jesus was on trial, Peter was in the courtyard below. 3 times people asked Peter if he knew Jesus, but 3 times Peter denied knowing him. Then the cock crowed, and Peter remembered what Jesus had said, and he wept. Jesus was then taken to Pilate, the Roman governor. Pilate knew Jesus was innocent, but the crowd shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And Pilate was afraid. So Pilate let Barabbas, a murderer, go free instead of Jesus. They dressed Jesus in a purple robe and a crown of thorns. Jesus was crucified on Good Friday with a thief on the side of him. At 12 o'clock, in the middle of the day, darkness came over the whole land for 3 hours. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then he breathed his last. When the Roman centurion saw how Jesus died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." After Jesus died, his body was placed in a tomb, and a heavy stone was rolled across the entrance. When the Sabbath was over, Mary and the women came early on Sunday morning to anoint Jesus' body, according to the Jewish custom. But when they got there, the stone had been rolled away, and the tomb was empty. An angel told them the good news. Jesus is not here. He has risen from the dead.
So I said the idea isn't to dumb down the Easter story, but is to reveal the Easter story to a generation who don't know it. Because when I stand in front of the whole of Penwortham School and say, what is Easter about? It's eggs, bunnies and chicks. And we know the truth, don't we? So we want to communicate that. So hopefully that's been an encouragement to you to know that the kids in the school have this Easter heard the story, and really a call for you to pray for those 100 so kids that came into the garden and got to engage. We know that the challenges mean they're probably not going to rock up here on a Sunday morning just yet. But if we keep going, then maybe one day they will be worshipping with us, praising God, knowing Jesus as their Lord and Saviour for themselves. Amen? Amen. We're going to pray together using the Lord's Prayer as we've been doing to help our kids to learn it. So loudly and proudly, let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Well, friends, I'm going to invite the band to come back and join us. There's quite a few of them today, so it'll just take them a moment. While they're getting ready, why don't you turn to the person next to you and share one bit of good news from this week? Find one bit of good news to share while they're getting ready. Janet, there is one bit, I promise you. Fabulous. And will you stand with me as you are able as we sing together In Christ Alone?
Then bursting forth in
glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since Christ has lost his grip on me, for me and me, and he is mine, bought with the precious
to take your seats. Phoebe is going to come and share with us this morning's reading. She's popped her copy down. There we go. Do you want to use Hannah's mic?
Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the other foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you were looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus turned to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
Amen. Thank you, Phoebe. Well, friends, we all know, don't we, that life can be tough. We only have to look at the news to see disaster after disaster, sometimes on a personal scale, sometimes in a country scale, sometimes on a global scale. And that can cause us to weep and mourn. But I do know that God has a promise for us. See, in Psalm 30, the promise begins with this phrase, "Weeping may last through the night." And for some of you, I know that the weeping is not just for one night. It's for 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 and 9 and on. I know that. But the promise that comes next is this. Weeping may last through the night. Joy comes in the morning. Night may just delay the dawn, but it can't defeat it. Morning comes round each day, and each day is a new opportunity to grab hold of joy. Do you need to know this promise? See, Mary Magdalene needed to know this promise. Bless her. She gets a bit of a bad rep, doesn't she? Let's be honest. So today, there's no costumes. I'm not going to come out dressed in anything wild and wonderful. I'm simply one scarlet woman talking about another scarlet woman. But one thing we do know about her, amongst all the speculation, is that all four Gospels testify that she was the first person to see and hear Jesus. So she must be pretty important. And that's got us all a little wondering. At the start of the service, we had the video that talked about Mary going into the tomb, and it led into that beautiful song that Francesca's rewritten. And it's rewritten from the perspective of Mary Magdalene. It's rewritten to help us to understand her part in this story, because her part in the story reflects something of our part in the story too. See, we know a little bit about her, but people do get a little bit confused too. Some have speculated that she was the woman who was about to be stoned in John chapter 8. But John doesn't share the woman's name, so we can't prove it. Others connect her with the woman in Luke chapter 7 who bathed Jesus' feet with tears, dried them with her hair, and anointed them with oil. But again, she's not identified as such, and then Luke identifies Mary in the next chapter. So we can't be sure about that either. Some have associated her with Mary of Bethany, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, but her name suggests otherwise. For names then, not so much now, but in some cultures, yes, names have meaning. And so her name, Mary Magdalene, shows that she is from the Magdala region in Galilee, not Bethany, which is in Judea. So it's unlikely that she's the same person there. Now, where the trouble comes in, really, is with Pope Gregory. Now, Pope Gregory I just made a passing reference, as ministers often do in a sermon, calling her a sinner. And that has spawned centuries of debate about who she was, what kind of a lady she was, and whether she was around in the night or the day. She's depicted, though, in all images of her. If you do a little Google later, she's always wearing red. The Scarlet Woman, as we've known her. So as I said, this is just one talking about the other. And while we don't really know what she looked like, what happens in this story does give us a little indication of what's going on inside her. For she is listed as one of the women who financially supports Jesus. She's not a side to the story. She's deep in the story. And she might not be named one of the 12, but, well, we all know that most of the women weren't named full stop. So we'll go with that. But she was there. And one of the things that is definitely clear about who she is she was the woman in Luke who was delivered from 7 demons. Now, 1 demon is more than enough, really, isn't it? But 7. So what we can ascertain is that Mary was someone who knew trouble and strife, who knew that things could be better and they weren't quite as they could be. And so she went and found Jesus, and the story is she heard him teach, she was healed herself, and then she journeyed with him, helping to pay his expenses, learning from him as she walked alongside him. And the story says that she was always near Christ, probably why she's got a bit of a bad reputation, because why was she so near to Christ? And as we gathered together on Maundy Thursday, Anna was reflecting on just the women's sheer devotion. Their lives had been transformed by Jesus. And if your life has been transformed with Jesus, then you want to walk with him, right? So she's walking with him all the way. When the others flee and run, hiding for their lives, she is there in the background. She watches him die. A death from crucifixion, not an easy thing to do. I don't know if any of you have ever watched The Passion, the film. It's quite hard to watch. And when I was at Bible college, they made us watch it. They made us sit and watch it because it's the nearest depiction of a crucifixion that we're going to get. It's brutal. And everything within me wants to run out the room when I'm watching it, but you have to stay. You have to stay and endure. And Mary stayed and endured. Endured to the point that when Jesus is dead, she's one of the ones that takes his body and tends for it. And I know that some of you in this room have had that experience in of being with someone as they have died and you have tended for their body. It is the most intimate thing you can do for someone. To derobe them, to wash them, to hold them, and to reclothe them. She was so devoted to Jesus that her intimacy with him continued. And of course, on Saturday, she kind of had to observe the Sabbath. That's what you have to do. But when Sunday came, she was up and out of bed early. Who was up and out of bed early this morning? A few of you. With the clocks changing, that was hard, right? That was hard. But she was up and out of bed and gone. But when she arrives, it's like a nightmare to her. She's been walking, she's been planning, she knows what she wants to do. She's got a scheme of what's going to happen. She's got in her head that she will see her Jesus again to sort him out a little bit more. And he's not there. And we can only begin to try and understand the feelings that would have run through her head and her heart. Where is he? This man that I have loved so dearly, this man that has transformed my life and given me purpose and meaning, has been taken. And then we know the story continues. She assumes that grave robbers have gone. She tells the others in different parts of the version, we hear different things. She tells the disciples that he's not there and they go back with her because they don't quite believe her. That's a story for us all to learn from, right? Believe the women. They go back and he's not there. And so the others go on off, but she lingers. There's this lingering. She still wants to be close to him. And so the way of being close to him is by being in the last place he was. And I know many of you will know that feeling. To be in the last place your loved one was. Has meaning, doesn't it? And so there she is. And the angels are there, but she doesn't know they're angels because she's so caught in her grief, in her loss, in her pain and suffering. She doesn't really get it. But what she does get is when Jesus says one thing, just one thing, her eyes are opened. He says her name. He just simply says her name. I mean, if you're going to have a comeback story, you probably want something a little bit more dramatic, right? You want a big spark of thunder, lightning, maybe, you know, an hasta la vista, baby. I am back. I don't know. You want a big thing. But Jesus simply says her name. For her, Jesus had known her. Not known the stories about her and taken that for face, but had known her, who she was. He had seen her, and she knew that she'd been seen. Maybe Moulin Rouge has got it right all along, and the greatest thing is to love and be loved. That's her story. She loved and was loved. And so when this guy who had been with her through this amazing transformation, this season in her life that meant so much to her, said her name, the spark happened and she realized. She knew who he was and she knew once again who she was. And so I want to encourage you today, because Mary had dark, dark moments. Seven demons, pretty dark, friends, pretty dark. Dark moments. And yet through Jesus, her life was transformed. She found a new sense of purpose and a new identity. And regardless of what the men then said, and the men have said about her through the centuries, she knew who she was and she knew whose she was. And she had joy in it. And for some of you, that's your story too. For some of you, Jesus has transformed your life and you know who you are and whose you are because of him. And that song that we've sang there, In Christ Alone, is one of my favorites. Do you know why? Because it says this, no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand. And some of you have experienced that. You've experienced man scheming and plotting against you. Gosh, some of you have experienced church people scheming and plotting against you, haven't you? Let's be honest. Some of you have been led to think that whatever you've done in life means that you are not good enough for Jesus and that you can't come to him. People have told you, not you, you're an abomination. It's not true. Shake it off. It's not true. If Jesus came for Mary, if he transformed her, healed her, and put her on a different pathway, then I sure am sure he's come for you too. And he wants you to have joy. Darkness comes, but we are not immune from it. We know, so does the morning come. And sadness comes, we all know that, but so too does joy. For Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I want you to take home something today that just reminds you of joy. So on your tables, upstairs on the top, there's some little crosses. And the crosses are little sun catchers that you pop in your window. And there are some pens on the tables for you to colour it in. So that when you go to sleep at night, when you put it in your window, when you go to sleep at night, you won't see it. When you pull back the curtains in the morning, you will see it and be reminded of joy. Ernest has already done his. Ernest, come here. Come here, stand up here and show the people. He got super excited, he's done it. Fabulous. So now as the band play this song again for you, I just want you to think about it from the perspective of Mary Magdalene. And to think about your sun catchers tomorrow morning as you throw those curtains wide. Over to you, band.
Days like this, sing Jesus is alive.
what? On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive. 'Cause holy Lord, you've made it right. And only now I see the light. The storm has moved, you've gone away. Saint Jesus is alive, yeah. Throw those curtains wide. On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive, yeah, yeah. Throw those curtains wide, yeah. On days like this, Saint Jesus is alive, Jesus.
Well, friends, I've just got, if you'll take a seat, I've just got a few notices. Band, stay where you are, because it's just a short little notices, and then we're going to go into our final hymn. Just to say that it is the Easter holiday, so tomorrow is a bank holiday, so we'll let Hannah have a day off. And because it's the holidays, things are a little bit different, so if you would usually engage with midweek stuff, please check with the people. You've got the directory if you're a church regular. You know who to contact for different things. But food bank does not stop. The food bank continues. So please do pray for food bank, pray for the volunteers and everything there. In the notices, there were just a few things for people to remember and people to remember. So please do remember Lester, Rebecca, Helen and Omar as they are ill. And also remember the family of Isilda as they grieve. Please pray for the leadership team, especially over the next 3 months, because it's Sunday today, but Monday's coming. And I'm taking a sabbatical. So next week, I won't be here, but Janet and the team will be here, and I will see you again in July. If you have any problems at all while I'm away, then Hannah and Francesca and the rest of the team are here. They will love to serve you. Won't you, team?
Yes.
Yes. Fabulous. Okay, kids, all the kids, that's if you're under 18, okay? I know some of you are children at heart. We have Easter eggs here as a gift from us to you. So if you are under 18, do come and get an Easter egg to take it with you. Be blessed, have a lovely holiday. Take care of yourselves and those that you love. But for now, we're going to stand as we're able to as we sing our final hymn of the morning, Thine Be the Glory. Let's give it a good shout, shall we?
Thou art dead, hast won.
So Easter joy is to be shared, to be grown, to be treasured. And as we go out into the world, into a new week, may the joy be our strength, our inspiration, our refuge in times of trouble and challenge. Take your crosses with you, and tomorrow morning, hang them in a place so that when you throw your curtains wide, you can sing loudly and proudly that Jesus is alive. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, friends.
So we're just going to carry on a little bit more boogieing. And can you just give a hand to the band? Because they've worked so hard. So it's like the Bailey Von Trapp family. So it's all my crowd, basically. They got roped in. I told them they wouldn't get Easter dinner unless they played.
We get Easter dinner. Thank
you.
Take the shot.